Good evening. At 6:30, I'll call this meeting to order. All rise for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, with that, I will take a motion to approve the agenda.
Madam Chair, I'd like to make a motion to amend the agenda by removing item 12, policy discussion.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
I'll second that.
Motion by Cordes, second by Beam to amend the agenda. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, so then can I get a motion to approve the amended agenda?
I'll make a motion to approve the amended agenda.
Second.
Motion by Carrero, second by Cordes. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, we'll move on to good news.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the school board, our wonderful audience tonight. Have a number of things, so sit back. First, congratulations to the Farmington High School robotics team, who competed in the Minnesota 10,000 Lakes regional competition at Williams Arena and had its most successful year yet. 63 teams from across the globe, two teams from China, competed in this year's game called Recycling Rush. After 9 qualifying rounds, Farmington High School came in ranked number 12 and formed a 3-team alliance with Roseville High School and Bloomington Jefferson High School for the finals. Their alliance advanced to the quarterfinals, where they were eliminated, placing them 5th overall for the competition. These students put in countless hours designing, building, programming, scouting, and fundraising over the course of the entire school year to make this happen. Next, congratulations to Bachman Middle School student Christopher Torres, a member of the G team who qualified to compete at the 2015 USASA National Snowboarding Championships held at Copper Mountain in Colorado. Christopher placed 51st in the halfpipe. Also, congratulations to Casey Medcalf, history teacher at Dodge Middle School, who was one of 25 teachers nationwide selected to participate in a National Endowment for the Humanities education program. His particular seminar will take place at the Center for American Music in Pittsburgh. The focus of the seminar is improving American history, history instruction through the integration of music into the curriculum. Mr. Medcalf has a strong background in music and will work to renovate his Civil War Reconstruction unit using authentic Civil War Reconstruction music as part of this experience. And also at back to Bachman, Bachman Middle School House of Reps sponsored Penny Wars to benefit Leukemia and Lymphoma Society. The goal was to collect many pennies as possible in their classroom jar and put as many non-pennies in everyone else's jar. Pennies gave each class positive points, while nickels, dimes, and quarters, and any dollar bills, took points away from the class's total. By the end of the competition, Bachman Middle School students had raised a total of $3,000. Winning Tiger Times received a pizza party. Sixth grade winner was Mr. Grain's class, seventh grade winner was Ms. Smith's class, and eighth grade winner was Mr. Waldbling's class. Thanks to all who donated to help this great cause. And finally tonight, just another awesome thing, Stepping Stones, a Farmington community education program, has earned accreditation from the National Association for the Education of Young Children, NAEYC. The nation's leading organization of early childhood professionals. We're proud to have earned the mark of quality from NAEYC and be recognized for our commitment to reaching the highest professional standards, said Sarah Sandvik, coordinator for Stepping Stones. NAEYC accreditation lets families in our community know that children in our high quality program have teachers who create engaging classrooms, enhance relationships with their parents and families, and develop rich experiences for their students. To earn this accreditation, Stepping Stones went through an extensive self-study process, measuring the program and its services against the 10 NAEYC early childhood program standards and more than 400 related accreditation criteria. This program received this accreditation after an online visit by assessors to ensure that the program meets each of the 10 program standards. NAEYC accredited programs are also subjected to unannounced visits during their accreditation, which lasts for 5 years. In the 25 years since this accreditation was established, it has become a widely recognized sign of high quality early learning, early childhood education. Nearly 7,000 programs are now accredited nationwide, but that's still only 8% of all preschool and other early childhood programs. So congratulations, everyone.
Great, thank you. Next item is superintendent update.
I really have nothing for you tonight. After that, all that speaking, I think it's probably good if you
all right.
move on.
Perfect. We don't have any student school board members this evening, and so nor do we have any public comments. So we will move on to the consent agenda. The consent agenda is made up of routine business items that can be acted upon with one motion. If any board member wishes to discuss an item, they may request that it be pulled from the consent agenda, and it will be acted upon separately. Does anyone have an item they wish to discuss? Hearing none, I will take a motion.
I'd like to make a motion to approve the above consent agenda.
Second.
I have a motion by Saucer, a second by Carrero. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Motion passes. All right, we will move on to reports and communications. And iPad discussion for K-2 classrooms is first on our topic. And we have Mr. Andrew Baldwin and company. I'll let you call them up as...
All right. Say good evening, Chair Singwell, members of the board, Superintendent Haugen, community. Thank you again for the opportunity to bring back and continue our conversation that we had from 2 weeks ago at our workshop session, largely around when we're talking about here in Farmington our effort to customize and personalize learning, and more specifically tonight, I want to bring back some new data because we had some questions coming from the board in terms of how does this specifically relate to the ratio of iPads use in K-2. So I have some data there that I'd like to share as well as we move through that. And I will be joined this evening by several colleagues here in a little bit. But just to recap, we certainly just want to bring up to speed, perhaps some people are joining us here for the first time, a little bit of the presentation that we had last time, so you'll see a revisit on several slides. And so we shared last time talking about the strategic direction here of the district, and largely what we're talking about is that culture that's embodies certainly and identified in our strategic plan. And so we're talking about that culture that encourages that creativity, that innovation, and that desire to customize and personalize those learning opportunities for our students. We also took a look briefly at the research that was available to us and saying, well, we had 25 years of research as it relates to laptop initiatives in terms of one-to-one. And so as you look at those efforts and what that translates, that data coming back and saying that really when we get to the leveraging technology for learning, that those opportunities really can't be fully realized until the device is no longer shared, but it isn't in a one-to-one ratio to the students. We also took a look at some data. Yay, more data. And we'll have some more here tonight, so we'll get a chance to look at several pie graphs as well. But we looked at our 2014 community survey response, and you can see here our data coming in here as either very important or absolutely essential, 82% saying the importance of efficient and effective use of technology. That 2014 survey data also relating to 93% saying good or excellent in terms of their satisfaction with what was happening with Farmington in terms of the technology opportunities for students within the district. We also then took a look this past January at our Clarity data, and this was our first year, as you recall, that we surveyed our parents' data. And so we had 86% of those agree or strongly agree that technology use in class can enhance student learning. And just to put that in context, we really had that opportunity, and here's the nice thing certainly about surveys, we had a chance to provide voice to several individuals. And we had a response here on this one of 1,645 parents that had a chance to respond to that survey and give us this feedback, and that's how that one fell. We also felt it was important to actually touched base with the kindergarten students themselves, as well as first and second graders, and we had 82% of those indicating that they saw that using that iPad in class could help them learn. We also asked their opinion in terms of what learning enjoyment looked like, and again, we had very high marks there at 81% of the K-2 student population. We also then went back to our clarity data, and one of the questions we had is whether or not we could disaggregate the information that we had to our teacher population to see if we could just get our K-2 teacher population. And unfortunately, the way that was constructed, I was not able to get that data. I reached out to our folks at Bright Bites, but part of that, the way it's structured, part of it, the way it was to provide anonymity in terms of encouraging open and honest feedback, we did not aggregate down to the individual teacher level and what grade level they taught. We'll see some later data this evening where individuals have chosen to self-identify themselves in some of their comments in terms of the follow-up survey that we added. But in this case, in our clarity data, we couldn't get to that. But what this one does highlight is that we philosophically were there. We're looking at our K-12 population of our teachers. 96% of them are indicating either agree or strongly agree that technology use in class can enhance student learning. So I think that's a huge benefit that we have in our favor. We also took a look at the very overall case score in there, and we did identify and say, you know we do have issues still with professional development. Now, a lot of this in terms of that data relies in terms of time, and time is the currency that we have as educators to spend, and there's only so much of it. And so that's been a part of it. And we also realize that we still have work to do in terms of what does that mean in terms of those 21st century skills of how do we communicate, how do we collaborate, how do we critically think, and how do we allow for creative opportunities for our students. But what was interesting was I was able to get in here, and I wanted to poll a little bit, and I wasn't able to get to our K-2 population, but I was able to get to our elementary population, because one of the conversations that we had in terms of that workshop session was to say, well, let's hear from those K-2 teachers. Well, I was able to get it to the elementary teachers, and what was interesting in terms of that professional development, what they were asking for, now this is a K-5 data, but what this relates is that the top two elements for teachers, K-5, was that they really would like additional opportunities for classroom management with technology. And the other one in there was leveraging multimedia for learning opportunities. And so those were the two that came in most frequently. And so we said we needed to go a little farther than that. And we need, in order to do this, we need to get specifically and prompted certainly from the board to say, how do we get additional information from our K-2 teachers directly? And so we conducted another survey in between our two times that we've met here this evening. We had about an 85% response rate from our K-2 teachers. This pie graph just simply represents what that means in terms of numbers from the respondents on here. In the subsequent slides that we'll see these things broken down into percentages, but keep in mind that we've got a smaller body of responses to look at. But again, it represents about 85% of our K-2 teaching population that was able to respond to the survey for us. All right, here we go, another graph. So, one of the first prompts that we asked of them was to how frequently do you have students using iPads in your classrooms? One of the prompts from the board was saying, well, we'd really like to know how often are they using these, because the context of that question was, what would that look like if we had to share these devices or go to a cart-based model where we don't have devices in a one-to-one ratio to our kids? And so putting that prompt before them, we got an idea here in terms of the responses, and we had coming back in that 67% of them said that they use it multiple times a day. This is an opportunity to shed light in terms of how practical would it be in terms of how do we get a cart from one teacher to the next classroom to have whatever the learning activity is happening in that time to have some relevant context. The other piece to this here is we see we have that 2% here, and again, based upon our population, that's really one teacher responded. And we rounded up to two in terms of that percentage of the overall population, saying that they use it less than twice a month. But when we look at this data, we certainly have a lot of people indicating that it's a multiple times a day over that learning periods that they're using those devices. But that data only gets us so far, and one of our objectives here this evening was also to provide some feedback here in terms of giving some voice to what this means in terms of hearing from our teachers as well. And so up here we have Ms. Watson here from first grade Farmington Elementary, and Brianna Buck here to share a few words also that's not easily conveyed in a graph. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Rachel Watson, a first grade teacher at FES. I've been working on adding iPad lessons for the past 3 years. I wanted to share some ways tonight on how I use my iPads in the classroom. For spelling, we use A+ spelling to practice words their way, and I've seen their scores increase the weeks that we use this app. We use RAS Kids almost daily, which allows students to listen, read, record, and take comprehension quizzes on books at their individual levels. This increases fluency, comprehension, accuracy, and expands my students' vocabulary. The instant data that I receive helps to guide my instruction to meet the needs of each individual student. I have used StoryKit to have my students create multiple books focusing on various skills. My students are practicing math facts daily using Extra Math. I have seen great improvement in my students' ability to recall math facts. This program allows my students to work at their own speed and their own level, providing an individualized learning experience. In my classroom, while some students are working on mastering addition facts, others are working on division. I have used Schoology for discussions and quizzes. This allows every student to have a voice and participate equally and collaborate with their peers. I believe that iPads enhanced my teaching and my students' motivation and engagement. I don't use them for every lesson, but definitely every day. The iPads have allowed me to differentiate and meet the wide range of all of my students.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. So that brought us to the next prompt that we had in this sequence in terms of, well, what would that look like if we changed that ratio from a 1-to-1, which we currently have and have had for the last 3 years, K-2, and if we altered that to a cart-based model. And so what we did here in this prompt was to say, well, what would that look like if we went from a 1-to-2, and we had some questions about, well, what would that ratio look like? And all the way to a 1-to-4 was that prompt in terms of what that would look like for their classrooms. And so the data coming back on this one indicates that 62% of those responding said, yes, this would have a significant impact to how they're doing things in their classrooms. And again, the goal here is to shed light in terms of what does that mean in terms of how accessible would these devices be if we shifted from what we currently have. To give additional comments and perspective on this, we have Ms. Schlusher here. Even though you told me how to do it, I botch it. But nonetheless, what her words are here to share with us, grade 2 teacher from Riverview. Thanks.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Lisa Schlusher, and I am second grade at Riverview. Some of you have been in my classroom to observe what I've been doing. Thank you for allowing me to share how the iPads have enhanced my teaching. The biggest fact that I'd like to take a look at is the modified flip math that I do on the iPads. It's not a true flip model, but in second grade, they stream within the classroom. It helps students that have a hard time focusing on direct instruction. They can go through the direct instruction on the iPad. If they need to re-listen to what I have to say, they can go back and do that. I found that children that have a hard time focusing, that this seems to be much easier for them to focus on what they need to get. I also use the paper pencil that goes along with it. They use manipulatives that go along with it also, but the iPad lets them work at their pace, so that they're being able to listen to and rewind if they miss something. This is all delivered through Schoology, so that if the child misses, they have the opportunity to work on this at home and still stay caught up, that I don't have to worry about them getting behind, that parents, I can send out information to the parents and tell them this is the lesson we're on, that they can continue on and not miss their lesson if they're able to. Okay? So the NWEA scores that I've noticed using the flip math method is unbelievable. I've had children that have had a hard time scoring high on that have come in at the beginning of the fall scoring on the MAP test below second grade level. They're at first grade level, and with using this type of math lesson, I've had such great success that I've had students exit second grade and are on task, they're on grade level, that they've risen that many points within the NWEA scores, which to me was wonderful. I build in my lesson plans a challenge piece so that I'm not forgetting about the students that can go above and beyond. So there is an opportunity for them to be challenged and work on that piece too. The thing that was an affirmation for me was the students that never got a chance to get to the challenge before, when you're doing direct instruction and not letting them work at their own pace, was that when you saw that look on their face come to you and say, Mrs. Slusher, I got to the challenge today. And they were so excited that they got to be participating in that extra above and beyond skill to reinforce and make sure that they've got that skill mastered. So that's been an affirmation for the students and an affirmation for me that this is the route I need to go for my kids. So I use my iPads daily in my math, so sharing would be a little difficult. The next step for me in my math is to take a look and see how I can let second graders be self-paced in their math lessons so that they can pace themselves within a timeline and then at the end build something into a project base where they can show me in the real world what they can do with the skills that they've just learned. That's my next step. So I'm always, like I'm challenging students to change and move on, I'm always challenging myself to move on to new and different things too. The other thing that I kind of giggle at this year is because I've added what's called a Kahoot. I don't know if you've heard of that. It's an assessment that you do with the students. They all use their iPads. It's used with the smart board and the iPad. I have students begging to do Kahoots on a daily basis. And I finally said to them, do you guys realize that these are tests and assessments that I'm doing and you're begging me to do them? And they're like, yeah, but we want to do one every day. I'm like, okay. If that's, I even had one student ask me, can we get this read home? I'm like, not really. But they love doing that kind of stuff. And for me, it's helpful for me to see where they're at so I can pre-test and I can post-test by using this with the iPad. And they're thinking it's all great fun, and they are learning from it. And I'm learning from them for that. I just want to let you know also, in K-1-2, we are laying the groundwork for students to become good digital citizens so that they understand when they're out there that this is what is okay, and we're laying that groundwork for them. So it's important that they be able to continue that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right, so then our third prompt was an open-ended prompt that we offered up to our K-2 teachers. And so we certainly staged that and set the context for that one again, to again grounding it in our strategic direction. But we did ask them to please share one or more examples of how students have used iPads in your classroom to create collaboratively, collaborate, critically think, or communicate in their learning activities, and how these learning activities would be changed if iPads for students had to be shared across your grade level. So we had this piece, and I'm pulling back that pie graph that we had before, because not surprisingly, based upon the comments that we had in those open-ended comments, there's a correlation between if someone was not using it heavily, they're not going to see an impact in their classroom. And so there's not a big surprise there in terms of where our lower numbers here are in terms of those responses. And inversely, that's true as well. Certainly those people that were heavy users of those devices certainly had some additional insight in terms of what impact that would make to them. And in just a little bit, we're going to hear from Dr. Geis, but I just wanted to summarize some of those comments that we came in because there were some thematic elements that came in based from these comments. And overall, we had about 16 pages of comments coming in from our teachers, and some were very detailed in terms of outlining their entire day or multiple discipline areas on here. And so when we look at that smaller number of people saying no, it wouldn't have any impact, interestingly enough, we only had one of those individuals that was the respondent who said, well, I only use them less than twice a month. We had other people that said, well, it would be a minimal impact, but I use it multiple times a day. And then the data coming out of that was the conversation saying, well, the way I work, I do a lot of pairing group work or have activity types of things, so that we had a couple instances where we had, I wouldn't see this as a big impact, but I do use it multiple times a day. But the vast majority of our data was falling in this camp of that it would significantly impact their learning and for a variety of things. instances. And so those common themes were coming around as we heard our teacher speakers here this evening speaking about just the spectrum of various disciplines that they were utilizing these devices for. It wasn't just a single function type of device. So we had lots of things on the language arts types of things in terms of reading at grade level kinds of opportunities, the writing opportunities that this presented for our kids. Mathematics, they identified numeracy and geometry on there. We had science examples in there and using the camera built into the device to say, you know what, we're looking at plants, we're looking at mealworms, let's take a picture. So, you know, as we go home over the weekend or we come back or at the end of our unit, we have an opportunity to go back and see what happened. And again, all of that going into the opportunity for kids to respond if they're doing a log. We also had some of our teachers respond and say, for even our specialists, say, hey, I know they use these things in our music, or I know these are bringing these down to our media specialists or information technology literacy specialists for the time that they spend with those individuals as well. Communication, as we heard here this evening, people had identified the use of Schoology in terms of not only the communication for teacher to student and student back, but we also had highlights of communication with the parents in terms of having information available and their estimation that that would be impacted if we had minimal opportunities here in terms of less than a one-to-one. And then we also had some of them also comment on the opportunity for to post what kids are doing on schooling to share their examples as well. A lot of voices here as well in terms of that customization and the language they were using on here was differentiation and individualization. Many of them spoke to the personal interests of their kids and this being a vehicle to help do that. Creation was a heavy theme in here with students having opportunity to create digital books. As I said, they're writing examples. We had some saying they had used apps such as EduCreations, which allows you to, it's a recording whiteboard app, so kids could explain their thinking. So not only could you see what's happening, but you could hear their voice and their thought process, which is something that you just can't do analog. You get that paper handed in, but you can see what the answer was, but you lose that opportunity to find out, well, what was the thinking that went on to get this? So, you know, teachers make their best assumptions in terms of the other markers that they have in terms of lending some support. Many of them spoke to balance in terms of this is one of those tools that we have available for our kids. It's certainly going to be in their environment, but what's the most appropriate tool for the job? And as we heard here this evening, we say, well, I don't use it for everything, but where it makes sense, we're going to try and leverage it and use that. Immediacy of access was another one that we had on here. In terms of when they have that teachable moment. Some teachers had commented on when they had cart-based models in the past where it was difficult to get a hold of them when you needed it. There's also instances where you have those people who are going to leverage it, will leverage it, and so then it doesn't get to be accessible to all when we talk about things such as an equitable kind of access. We spoke of the multimodal learning with text and pictures, video being available as well. There's some highlights there in terms of early literacy and the value of having a multimodal approach in terms of encouraging with pictures and sound as well. There was comments I'm referring to here in terms of after 3 years in, it would feel like we're taking a step backwards if we change this ratio in our K-2 environment. And then the immediacy of access on there also highlighting in terms of, as I mentioned on the onset here at the front of this section, talking about what's the opportunity to have kids in age appropriate, reading level appropriate, interest level kinds of things accessible to them as well. And so the other piece to that we had Lisa also spoke to the feedback and where we can do those formative assessments. And one of the pieces in RAS Kids was an element that was identified several times here in terms of having that feedback so that immediacy of feedback for the teacher to be more prescriptive in terms of who do I need to have some additional time with. And I'll conclude with that portion in terms of the summary of those comments, also speaking to time. And they were speaking of the opportunity because they had that access to the time and having the opportunity for have kids be engaged in on-task, age-appropriate kinds of activities. It afforded them an opportunity through the feedback that they were getting from any digital kinds of assessments here or their Schoology piece of who they needed to work with. And they could change that ratio of at work so it wasn't everyone has to do the exact same thing at the exact same time, but I could have kids meaningfully engaged in learning activities and pull aside the types of kids and pull apart those different learning activities and concepts that I can work with the students in that smaller ratio. So that was a summary of those comments, but I also wanted to provide an opportunity that you could hear a principal perspective as well. And so I'll turn it over to Dr. Geis.
Thank you. Good evening, Madam Chair. How are you?
Good. How are you, Dr. Geist?
Excellent. Thank you. Thanks for having me here this evening. I could summarize, and I could be really short, that being if we took a step back, it'd be devastating. And I can end my comments there, or I have other things to share if you'd like the longer one.
Longer one,
perfect. What have I seen? And this is what he asked me to present. I've seen transformation. I've seen it not only in our staff, but in the students and in the community of learners at North Trail Elementary. In addition to that, that we've seen this growth, that being when we first started it, where there was a substitution of the technology. Now it's not that. It's seeing students creating things. It's seeing students explore. It's seeing students sharing things beyond our district, beyond that, and it's wonderful. Students are having a deeper understanding. Students are understanding and learning their strengths. And then also, what are some of their limitations? When he was talking about RAS kids, they know where they're at. They're able to monitor. They're able to set goals and work on that. Some things that I see students every single day, and this demonstrating and learning, see number one, that it's flexible, that they're able to demonstrate that, they're able to use their creativity, there's authentic learning taking place. They're sharing and they're discussing their works, and again, beyond our classrooms. It's easy for students to view not only their own works, but their peers, and to provide that feedback and forth. It's also raising the bar because it's motivating and it's engaging for the students. It's allowing students to progress at their own pace. It's also helping students to reason better, and they need to be able to explain that when they're recording themselves, they're listening to it back going, that didn't make sense. And also their methods and the strategies. It's real life learning. The frequently heard things, you know, in our building, Schoology, Notability, iBooks, RAS Kids, Book Creator, Creative Book Builder, Story Kits, Chatter Picks, Genius Hour, Educreation, QR codes when you're walking into the classrooms, Air Servers, Spelling Apps, Google Docs, GarageBand, Destiny Quest, Google Earth, where they're going and they're finding out locations and then going into the museums there, Dropbox, calendars. This just didn't come naturally. It took PD. It took Miss Buck coming in. And she has been absolutely marvelous. And prior to her, the previous people building on that professional development. It's also the technology department that when we have problems and troubleshooting. So it just isn't the teachers in the classroom. It's the support and how we're working collaboratively and growing. And it's just absolutely wonderful. And so behind that, and you saw that in the teachers' comments, in our building, we had 100% filling it out. And that the 100% would say that it's a definite setback, because I sent them an email last Friday and I said, in addition to the comments that you had, would you share some with me? They all did. But in addition to that, the specialist, because we had the carts. We were the first ones. Before the district had iPads, North Trail had two sets of them. And it wasn't equal. It was our PTP, and we did readathons where we were able to generate enough funds to buy them. They didn't get utilized as much because when you wanted to do something, they weren't available. So the cart model isn't even, you know, in my mind, isn't even a consideration that we need to have them there. I have some general thoughts. Number one, first and foremost, we're never going to replace those fantastic teachers. It's the teachers using the tools. In addition to that, I just want to go back just 2 days to tell you examples that I've seen. We had Grand Day on Friday, and you never get a second chance to make a first impression. We had almost 250 grandparents attending, and it's just for first grade. The students were the loudest I've ever heard them. It was so engaging. It was so wonderful because, unfortunately, some of our grandparents have a harder time hearing. And so I went. I wanted to find out why that was. Well, one of them was, well, they used a microphone for one of the songs. But the teachers, I went back, I said, they knew the song so much better. Why? Because the music instructor, Miss Hubert, put it out on Schoology. So when they were having their transitions in the classroom, the teachers were able to pull them up and they could practice during that transition going from one activity to the next. The students could look at it at home. They could pull it up if they wanted to. In addition to that, today I was asked to teach in an American history class. Hard concept, but my subject, my fort and my love, and it was on the timelines leading to the Revolutionary War, and I created a simulation. However, the simulation was 12 events leading up to it, starting with the Proclamation of 1763 leading all the way up to the Boston Massacre, with the Townshend Acts, the Declaratory Acts, the Intolerable Acts, the Sugar, and all those. Well, you know what? It's a foreign concept to the students. This was their first, for the fifth graders, their introduction to it. Put them in pairs, And they went on and we created a digital format and a timeline. So here's the principal going into a classroom using the technology that was available. If it were on a cart, it probably wouldn't be available for the day and time that I wanted to go and do that. It would be a huge step backwards. Other things that I've seen just this week is the Genius Hour, and then also Ms. Huppert shared with me an assessment using Notability. And what a powerful one. And this is for our primary learners, where she has the music playing and the students pick out on Notability what instrument, what family of instruments, whether it was percussion, woodwinds, or brass. It's instantaneous feedback for the students. That's the most important thing, so that they know what they're doing, when they're doing it well, and also to correct them. It's a time-saving management for Ms. Huppert, because it automatically gets graded for her. So that's another piece that I saw. So in closing, that it'd be a huge step backwards in this customization of the individual learning that we wanted and we're doing each and every day, that we really need to support our teachers, especially those that have gone into the professional development. Many of them came and said, you know what, if there's teachers out there, use survey information and ask them, you know what, if they don't want to use them, we do. And if they choose not to, we're going to take them and we're going to run with them because they're using them every day. If I were to quiz you, how many of you have used your iPhone or your computers today? And I'm not going to do that. It's something that they need to be accustomed to doing every single day. The other comments I'm going to add is the difference between, you're going to hear some choices of what type of iPads. We're not fans at North Trail of the Minis, the regular size. Why? Just for their dexterity, for the size, for them to be able to see, for our handwriting, that we start a little bit in second grade, but in third grade, and I know that's not one of the things, but in third grade, they are doing handwriting on them. So we need that larger screen for the smaller ones. Two other points. Number one, you know, how has it transformed me? If you were to look at my tweets just this last year, 150 of them, you would find between a third and a half, it depends on how you put it in there as your search engine, have been technology related. That hasn't been intentional. That's what I've seen taking place every single day. The tweet today was the students working with recorders and pacing themselves at their own rate and customizing their own learning. The other thing that we didn't do in the survey was to ask third grade instructors, how would this impact? Not next year, because they're coming in. So I did. I sent and asked my third grade teachers, and they said, whoa, that would be a huge step back. The SAMR model, where the students are at right now, they're able to come in at the ladder, that being the creativity. They'd be going back and doing the substitution, just bringing them up to speed. And so with that, I want to close, and I appreciate you choosing the longer version, and thank you very much for having us here this evening.
Thank you.
All right. So then this brings us to our other slide in terms of what our options were. And so two weeks ago, we took a look at this, and we said, well, there were five different plans that we had come forward. And the prompt of the question was, well, what would that look like if we changed that ratio in our K-2 realm? And so I wanted to explain this graphic here as well. And so what I tried to do is to highlight in terms of that continuum of where we were in terms of the administrative recommendation at that point in time, and then the three orange columns in there. And so again, each one of these proposals has three different financing options in there in terms of what's the overall expense and then what are some various financing options on there. But when we take a look at the far left-hand column, you've seen that one before, and that was the one that was the administrative recommendation at that point in time, saying how do we have this balance? How do we have the balance between what the budgetary needs are and what we have in terms of access on there? And so it does identify that iPad Mini 2 version on there. And while Dr. Geis has also spoken to this notion of size, when prompted and asked, we had conversations certainly with administration at that level. If it becomes larger or without, the answer is we want to have them, you know, in terms of that type of piece. And so that was the one we were looking at in terms of where that was for the, again, the desire and intent, if we go with that 4-3 financing in terms of structuring that over 4 years, but having that option in the third year to pay it off and the equity that we now have in those devices to hopefully make that fourth payment, it makes sense that we acquire what is the most current technology that we have available to us so that that value is even that same high
higher price point here 3 years in. When we look at those three orange columns in there, I put the little icon there for what that would represent in terms of how many students to each iPad on there. And so that first orange column on the left there talks about, well, what would that look like if we had the cost amount for one iPad for every two students. The middle orange column is one iPad for every three students, and then that final orange column there speaks to one iPad for every four students. Not surprisingly, it's less expensive because you're buying fewer devices. And so when we look at those standpoints, you got the spread there in terms of what that would mean, in terms of that reduction based upon what our student projections are moving forward. And so dividing that out in terms of what our K-2 population would be, and then having that uniform for those grade levels. So at this point in time, in terms of this graphic and certainly the one following here, is I want to open up in terms of what you may have in terms of questions, either in regard to that layout in terms of that spreadsheet piece, or anything else that you've heard this evening.
Madam Chair?
Go ahead.
You know, one question I had was, I know we had, last time you talked a lot more, I think, about the community survey and the support for technology, but have we ever asked the question in terms of supporting with tax dollars, the iPads, things, and the community surveys? Were in there any questions that kind of related directly to tax dollars?
We have not yet prompted to our community in terms of what it would look like in terms of a levy piece or those types of things. At present, we've been functioning in terms of what do we have at our disposal at present. We have in a position, because our devices are leased, we don't have the luxury of saying we would like to retain these devices until we get a chance to hear from our community and find out where they fall. Mm-hmm. Our leases are expiring. We need to return that equipment. It's cost prohibitive for us to buy them out at this point because for 3 years, mm-hmm. we've just been renting them. We haven't been putting any equity down towards them. So that's been the piece that's prompted us from having that that discussion.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yeah, Madam Chair, on this, Andrew, what's your recommendation moving forward? Would you recommend to the board which one of these?
Yeah, I think the administrative recommendation here in terms of how do we find that balance between our capital dollars that we're taking a look at here is again to say we're better off having a ratio of 1-to-1 than not providing that opportunity for our students. Talking with, as we said last time here, in terms of what is possible certainly within the capital funds to make that happen, we'd be looking at that first column bottom line there in that 4-3 lease, that $961,000 would be the piece. It's, again, the compromise is coming in the terms of that form factor, candidly, for our K-2 population. And as you know, in terms of when you have to make those decisions of where things fall, there's always got to be that compromise kind of piece. But the piece in terms of if you have to choose the one that's not as detrimental, they're saying we'd rather have iPads in a 1-to-1 ratio than to have larger screen and fewer of them, because then we lose some of those learning opportunities that we've heard here this evening.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, you know, one of the things that we heard quite a bit of at the community input sessions was that at least a lot of people in attendance, or a fair share of people, had mentioned that they were willing to give on the K-2 iPad situation. Did we consider any of that? I mean, it doesn't look like it's in the presentation anywhere, but I guess, you know, how does that play into the thinking here? I mean, I think obviously, you know, the teachers and you present a very compelling case about how this is really being utilized in education. But the fact is we, you know, and if we had unlimited dollars, I'd be all, you know, for this. I mean, obviously, like I say, the teachers are using this and there's learning opportunities, but we don't have, you know, money to access. And so I guess I'm struggling between hearing a lot of feedback that people in the community were willing to give on K-2 iPads, and just wondering how that factored in, if that was considered in any of the information that was put together.
I think it absolutely did consider it, and I think that's the piece in terms of how do we have multi-points of input. And so we certainly did, and I think it's very valuable that we had opportunities, as you are well aware of, in terms of our community roundtables and hearing feedback from people that way. And so one of the other pieces in terms of what we need to put together, because we're all very familiar with that because that's in our most recent history, but that's also why we took a look at trying how do we get additional vantage points. We heard from the teachers. We heard from the 82% of 900-some kids in terms of what they're saying in terms of that. We had 1,645 parents respond in January to that piece. And so I think that's that piece in terms of that balancing of, you know, how is this in context? And I know at some of the pieces at our roundtables, we had an opportunity to come forward with some FAQs in terms of to provide some additional information. I know we had some misconceptions early on saying, well, wait a minute, general dollars versus capital, can I just take our capital dollars and you know, if we're taking a look at program changes or things like that, that we said, well, these are really different. We took at the look at the long-term capital purchases types of things. And so I think the intent here was not to certainly dismiss any of that feedback, but to put in context and surround that the other opportunities we've had for feedback from a variety of audiences in that regard.
Right. So on the Bright survey, there was nothing in there about the cost of the iPads or anything. It was really about the use and how it's being utilized and so forth, right?
That is correct. The Bright Bytes is to the piece as it's correlated in terms of how you efficiently use the technology. It's not a piece on you know, how much does it cost. It also does ask some benchmark information in terms of how much technology is in the homes, as well in terms of where your community stands and ask for beliefs of the community, but not price points.
And then regarding the use of money, and you're right, this doesn't come from the general fund, it doesn't impact a lot of the things that we were looking at, but you know, in our district we've made a choice to use our operating capital, and we've made a priority of having technology be one of the things we spend that on, so that fund is put there from state funding for, you know, repair and maintenance of your buildings and anything that is, you know, subject to depreciation, essentially, including technology, and we've made a choice that technology is important to our district, and we've invested in it that way. Now, that being said, we are considering going for a levy and potentially for dollars that would impact that capital money, and so essentially, we've chosen to use some of that money to go towards technology instead of buildings, and later we're going to have to go back and ask for more money for buildings, essentially. So I just want to make it clear to our viewing audience and everything that while this wouldn't affect our general fund issues, it does still affect the fact that we need money to repair our buildings and upkeep them and so forth.
Correct.
Board Member Sasser.
Thank you, Madam Chair. In response to Member Beam's question regarding the roundtables, I want to address that during that time, we had issues on the table that people were very concerned about. They were worried about losing elementary band. They were worried about losing middle school sports. And at the time, the feedback was, well, try this, try that, try that. And as you mentioned, Mr. Baldwin, that we talked about, okay, well, these are the spot pots. This is how it works and how the funding has worked. So I want to just add that in a comment of how the perspective at the table at the time. In regards to the survey, first of all, I want to thank you for the work you've done putting it together, letting the board see the feedback, and I want to thank all the teachers that participated in the feedback. I enjoyed reading those 16 pages, and it was great to see how our teachers, especially those early elementary teachers, how they are utilizing the resources of the iPads and how they are using it to meet our strategic plan. And I found that very insightful, and I wanted to thank them for their time and thank the teachers that came here tonight to highlight what they've been doing. There's two questions I would like to ask. One, if you could clarify what's included in the proposal tonight, because previously you had mentioned. The second is one of the teachers mentioned that those early elementary grades are preparing the found work for digital citizenship that the students are learning. If you could highlight a bit of that, because I know I've heard community concerns about the use and length and even addiction to the screens. If you could address that, that would be great as well.
Sure. And I'll start with your second part first, if
fine.
I may. And so when we talk about that in terms of the digital citizenship, and you know, I could go longer if I could pronounce the word on that one.
So it wasn't just me.
That's why I was starting with, let's get the hard one out of the way because I can't say that word. But when we talk about that digital citizenship type of piece, we had heard here this evening from our teachers here as well in terms of what they have in terms of context. You know, we often hear about things of, well, let's set up, you know, in technology spheres, they talk about things, oh, a walled garden. Let's, you know, create a walled garden. Well, there are doors and openings in this wall, and we are in an era and age when there is media all over. And so what a fine opportunity from the earliest opportunity to start having in context, what does that mean in terms of having a digital footprint? And what does this mean in terms of our use and leveraging of Schoology? We've spoke of that in terms of, you know, how we can leverage that potentially here also with flexible learning days coming up, is that context of, well, how do I have a conversation? How are you in terms of your conversation and with other people? I had a meeting the other week with our information technology literacy specialists, and they've done a fine job and have been essential also in terms of saying, you know what, here's our core kinds of pieces, and we're going to leverage some things as it makes sense from commonsensemedia.org and have that in terms of our specialist time as they are there in our media centers typically. But the other piece to that is we look at the, and I know Dr. Geis had also highlighted this as well in terms of that professional development, that it really is, when we start leveraging this tool, it's everyone's responsibility on there. Our clarity data does get to that point. We did have a data point, and I didn't share it here this evening, but we did also in that clarity data survey parent comfort level with how comfortable are you talking with your students about digital citizenships. So I can't undermine that this is the realm and the era that we live in. It's certainly essential to that, and what a fine opportunity to certainly leverage that and play that to our advantage and openly acknowledge that as opposed to pretending it doesn't exist. And so I think there's huge advantages in that regard. Does that adequately address that?
Yes.
That second question. So the first then was on
Dr. Grace.
Oh, sorry. Okay.
And I have an example of that. You know, in kindergarten, I had one respond that it's that early technology literacy teaching responsibility. In first grade, immediately starting with the digital citizenship lessons, technology literacy and responsibility from day one, using iPads as a tool to access and to create, creating passwords on the iPad, safe usage of web surfing, not clicking on ads, filling out registration forms without parental consent, and those types of things. That's first grade. Second grade, continuing to build on that from day one, the iPad as a tool, and then also not clicking on it, but then also it just keeps building. And then the nice part is that if there is a mistake made, that the administration working with the teachers, that we're correcting it and communicating with the families, because you know what, to err is human. And so we do have those, and fortunately, it hasn't been in the primary grades, but in other grades and in visiting with my colleagues, but they're taking care of it masterfully.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
So then the first prompt to your question was then in terms of the proposals, and just a reminder from the things we had discussed last time, so that this proposal, when we look at these dollars, is certainly the devices themselves, but the other pieces that are packaged with them are in addition to the cases for these devices, so that we have these in the drop test rated case. We have a licensing that's included in this for the next 3 years that we are able to manage and control these devices essentially from our enterprise server. And the other piece that was new this year was that opportunity and identifying and picking up on where we saw a need, certainly coming back from our clarity data, was that we have a need for professional development. And so this is the one that also includes some professional development days as well that we could leverage again to make sure that we continue as people had spoken here in terms of where they were on that SAMR model, but to get to that point of how do we get this device in terms of our practices, and we're a relatively large organization. It's going to take some time. I think we've made huge gains in the 3 years, but we still have more to do. And the interesting thing with technology is it only is going to continue to evolve. And so that means there's going to be new opportunities to continue to leverage this thing and use it in ways that we previously couldn't imagine or do previously.
Board Member Cordes, do you have any?
I don't have a question as much as I just have a comment. I would just like to point out that I spent a few hours last week in a couple of our elementary schools, and some of the time was in the K-2 classrooms, and I think Dr. Geis put it well when he said it would be devastating if we lost this for those students, because in my time in those classrooms, they were on the devices almost the whole time. And just seeing the work that they were able to do with these devices, and how much that outpaces what I can do on these devices is astonishing, and I just hate for us to lose that. It's just a little bit of soapbox, but.
Madam Chair, first of all, I'd like to thank everybody that's presented tonight. It's great information, it's very compelling. But again, going back to the roundtables and listening to the public, one of their concerns was the expense to the iPads. You know, what would it look like from a financial standpoint if K through two was removed? How much of an impact is that to that number?
Removed?
Yes.
I would have to get back in terms of what that would mean if they did not have any devices K-2. And again, that would be in the student realm, and so I'd have to take a look at the actual numbers in terms of how many devices that would be. In terms of that, the piece I'll just throw out there, and I know it's more anecdotal, but we also have some of our partner districts, and I know in terms of comments we had in terms of, I know your prompt is a financial one, not a in practice type of piece, but when we talk about things being a step backwards, you know, we have districts, as I said previously, to our west and to our north, 3 years later, even some longer, are still trying to get to one-to-one. The other piece that I will highlight, and so I can get numbers in terms of, well, if we totally remove those from the population, but what is difficult to calculate is the cost of that action. We can figure out what the cost is in not purchasing those, but the impact to the system would be much more difficult to calculate, particularly 3 years in when we've made, as an example, some strategic decisions to say, let's reduce our printing costs, let's reduce our curriculum purchasing costs. Those are going to have some significant kinds of pieces that are not as easily ticked off saying, oh, you know, one less device. And I think the other piece here, and Superintendent Hagen had also mentioned here, the expense to the district in terms of what does that look like when you have multiple systems in place? What are the expectations, K-2 versus U3 through 5, where we talk about a concerted effort professionally in terms of the profession, PD and things like that would occur, that there's some cost there. But I can figure out what that would be if we just totally removed that population. And I can grab that information and get back to you.
You know, I want to make it clear, I'm not suggesting that. I'm asking because I do get a lot of questions on the financial part of this. I do like the one runs, and I've been to all the elementary schools and the schools to see the power of the tool as well. But I'd be curious if it's like $200,000, $300,000, just the impact so the public could see, you know, what that number looks like.
Madam Chair.
And on that request, I would just ask that can we get what the district has reduced in paper printing costs and curriculum costs over the last 3 years as well to be included? So we'd have, if we're going to get those numbers, to get the savings that the district has acquired from pre-iPad to now for curriculum and paper expenditures. Yep. In addition to that.
And that's a good point, because that was my other thing to bring up. Was I think the public needs to understand the significant savings we do have from the iPads and technology because of the paper as well.
May I add to the discussion? I want to just reiterate what Mr. Baldwin was saying, that we can't completely justify the cost of the paper savings, the curricula savings, so it'd be great to see that. The other piece is those savings come out of the general fund. So by adding cost in the general fund, ultimately it would translate down to class size. That's one way to look at it, in terms of where the pots are coming from. And to capitalize on the data that we asked for, it'd be going backwards. So I just want to just reiterate that.
Does anybody have any other questions?
I do.
Okay, go ahead.
In regards to the size of the device, Dr. Geis mentioned about the size, and I know some of the feedback. Which elementary schools have which size? And in that piece, I've been concerned about just the eye-hand coordination of younger kids. You think of kindergartners, they get the bigger size crayons. They usually use bigger devices because they have smaller hands, and that dexterity is difficult. And if we were to go to this mini models for all the elementaries for that K-2, do we know how that would impact, say, the specialist? Like, we heard about the music teacher that uses it daily in her class, and how that impact would affect the current practice. We've talked about equity across the district, and we know that each classroom has a little bit different use of the iPads and how it's integrating. I'd love to see a perspective of how that size difference might affect the instruction.
Yeah. So I can share with you in terms of our data here, we have 711 iPad 2s at Aiken Road Elementary and North Trail Elementary between those two sites. We've got 1,160 of iPad minis, largely at Meadowview Farmington Elementary School and Riverview Elementary School. When we look at our context of our overall deployment fleet of iPads, we're about half our minis. Part of this was 3 years ago in terms of the change of the processor and the iPad mini becoming available in terms of that, and so it was an opportunity to save, and presently these current configurations will speak to about a $93 difference per device to go with a larger form factor size, but you will not see an internal gain in terms of the newness of that processor, for example. In terms of the fine motor skills in that regard. We don't have data on that. Even the things of the research that I provided here by Damien B. Bell in terms of that, that the iPad studies are typically the data varies on there because typically are structured in terms of not so much the device but what you want to do with a device. And many of those studies are also speaking to what's the ratio. And many times that's the commonality is the ratio that they have in place, not what the task is that they wanted to do it for early literacy or...
What do you mean by ratio? Meaning
the ratio of
one-to-one.
Okay. That the common thing in the research is they say, well, here's our common thread. It's a one-to-one device. But what they want to do with it, they say, you know, we're going to boost our mathematics or we're going to boost our language arts, you know, types of pieces. Those are the variations on there. But in terms of the feedback, in terms of access to those, it becomes a... individual feedback type of thing. And I see you here, so Lisa, I'm going to turn that over to you.
I just want to comment on the difference in the sizes. I started out in the pilot program with the larger iPads, and then we went down to the minis. We've all got the minis. With the dexterity for children, for their fine motor, they're able to make things as big as they need to write in the space, so it really doesn't hinder them. And then when they're sending the document back to me or emailing it to me, it goes back to the normal shape and size for me. So they have the whole screen of the mini to write into if they need to. So truly the fine motor is not... The thing that I had to get used to is with my old eyes to be able to see in the smaller screen, but... You know, you adapt and adjust to it, and the kids seem to be working just fine with it. So as far as the fine motor, it worked fine.
I appreciate hearing your feedback that you've used both devices because not many, we don't have that perspective from many, so thank you.
You're welcome.
Any other questions? You know, just one comment. I think what many of us are struggling with is the fact that we are going to be looking potentially to ask the public for additional dollars in our district. We're faced with very challenging budget decisions. We've had lots of conversations this entire year. I think it's weighing on a lot of us in where we invest. And it truly is choices that we're making in this district and wanting to do the right thing. To Board Member Carrero and Beam's point, I do understand in the roundtables we did hear from a number of people targeting the iPads. iPads weren't on the list, so to speak, and you know, not to say that their comments weren't unimportant, but they were offering up opportunities to save something that was on the list as well. And I totally get that, and I don't want to discount that. But as I had a conversation earlier, we've made decisions to support things in this district, like irrigating the fields at the high school. Is it a necessity? We've had sports playing on those fields for many years. It's like concrete, and I'm sure those sports teams are glad that we're irrigating them, and we made a financial investment to have safer fields for our students. And so I don't think that, regardless of the decision tonight, I think that my point is we are really... We're not hearing the public. I think many of us are very struggling with limited resources and how do we meet the expectations and the support of our district as a whole and not pockets. And that is inclusive of the public that's helping fund this. It's supporting our teachers who are utilizing the tools in the classrooms every day. And so I appreciate the thorough work that you guys have done to try to bring us a very robust and thorough presentation over the course of this past month, because these decisions aren't easy for us, and we appreciate the effort that you guys put in outside of the board meetings to help us with them. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
All right. With that, we will move on. I will keep my comments very brief as to the, get to that spot. Second item in reports and communications is the board retreat recap. I thank my fellow board members and the handful of administration staff that were here for another additional 4 hours post last Monday's board meeting. A very different format than what we've historically worked in, and I appreciate people's willingness to try something different and collaborate in a way that we did. As far as a general recap, what we for the most part covered was looking at how we are structured, understanding roles and committees, how things get communicated back to the board, and then started the process of building board goals. We did review the district strategic plan. So we have the overarching strategic plan for our district. Each building has its own strategic plan, so to speak. And the board is currently in an effort to create our board strategic plan, essentially, our mission statement, objectives, and follow basically the similar practices throughout our district. Board Member Saucer and Board Member Lee agreed to help initiate the work with Ms. Barb Dufferin, and we're providing input on this mission. They're going to be making some recommendations, and then the board is going to come back, and we will probably have another board retreat, I believe, shorter board meeting, board retreat session, May, maybe June, depending on the timeline when things get complete. But one of the things that came out of the board retreat is that I had asked board members to survey ourselves. Board Member Saucer had brought up that at phase three training that both she and Board Member Carrero attended, one of the things that had come up was that how do boards self-assess themselves? And a recommendation was a survey. And so I'm going to ask you guys tonight if you felt that there was value in having that survey, and would you be interested in continuing that process as a board? Because what we could do is following not necessarily every board meeting, but once a month after the general business meeting, second one of the month, to send out a survey. It had, I think, 6 standard questions. It was included in some information I sent out. But did we stay on task? Are we following policy? Those sorts of things. If people feel that there's value in including something like that, I think we could definitely continue that practice. We can pilot it for a while and see if it works, and if not, then we can go another route. So any thoughts?
Madam Chair, if I can just speak to that. I find it interesting because as much as a board, we do so much work together, and sometimes our focus is on, you know, policy, budget, school, superintendent, and sometimes I think it's easy to forget the development piece we need to do together as a group, as a board. And it was just interesting that you had us do that survey and then going to the training going, oh yeah, we should take some time for reflection. And sometimes, at least for me, I can speak to myself, there's so many things that we're doing and we're, you know, dotting the I's, crossing the T's, and trying to get everything done, that I know I have a hard time sometimes sitting down for that reflection piece. And just having that to kind of pop in our face and just remind us to reflect, you know what, yeah, maybe we can work on this. And having that self-evaluation tool, just like we do with the superintendent, I think it's just as important that we do that ourselves. And I just like to advocate that I think it'd be something we could do simple. I don't think it would take more than a few minutes to do, you know. And I think it could help us improve as a board. I think it'd just be worth discussing.
Madam Chair? Yeah. I think it would be more, personally, I think it would be more beneficial if we would do it and have it be a deeper self-reflection than just the way that the meetings ran, but have it be more about the work that we're accomplishing and maybe doing it quarterly and having it be a little bit deeper reflection of how we're performing as a board rather than how the meetings went.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else?
Yeah, Madam Chair, I would agree with that. I think a quarterly review of logistically our accomplishments, did we meet our goals, where we stand at this point, do we have anything outstanding and so forth on that is what I would like to see.
Go ahead.
I think Either way, monthly, quarterly, every other week. I'm not suggesting that, but I think we should.
I can send him out daily to you if you'd like. No.
Daily would be nice. I think we should do something. The only way we will grow as a board, better ourselves in our jobs, is through this reflective piece. And I just wanted to thank you for facilitating the meeting. Mm-hmm. You did
thank
a
you.
Fantastic job.
Appreciate it. Agreed.
And Madam Chair,
yeah.
If I can add, I kind of like the idea of maybe combining the ideas of doing a simple monthly meeting, but then maybe a quarterly more in-depth self-board evaluation, and we could use those tools together to compile information, possibly. I mean, I'm not saying that the monthly ones would be lots of in-depth questions. Maybe the quarterly reports could have a little bit more in-depth time to it and then put it together.
So structure them more that the monthly one was more kind of the quick, did we stay on task, did we get in the, versus getting in the weeds, and then the quarterly ones are the more comprehensive set of, because I think, to be totally honest, if we did the blended model to start, we can see what works and bring it back and make any adjustments from there. Okay, so I'd like to make a suggestion that I'll utilize the MSBA questions that were offered up to start for that monthly one. And then when we come back together at our board retreat, that we do our homework as far as what do we feel like is going to be the best questions to include in a quarterly self-reflection. And that way, everybody has their homework now to start thinking about that. All right. Well, thanks again. And thank you to Jay and Barb and Lori for being part of that with us that night. So with that, I will take a motion.
I'll make a motion to acknowledge receipt of reports and communications as presented.
I'll second.
Motion by Cordes, second by Beam. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All right, we will move on to administrative action, and Ms. Marianne Thomas has the first topic.
Good evening. Chair Singwald, members of the board, Superintendent Haugen, and members of the community. Over the last few weeks, the administrators in our school district have been staffing their buildings based on the parameters and budget alignments that you have approved in the last couple of months. As part of that staffing, we need to non-renew some of our probationary teachers. So you have before you tonight a list of 20 teachers who are all probationary, that at this point we need to non-renew for the 15-16 school year. They're being non-renewed for a variety of reasons, whether they have a variance right now and have to be non-renewed, potentially rehired after July 1st. Some of them, another 10 or so, where we don't have a full position for them, that maybe they were full-time this current year, but maybe we don't have a full-time job for them next year. A couple for performance. So there's a variety of reasons that we're non-renewing staff. Some of them may be, in fact, rehired with some of the postings that we're going to be doing over the next few months. We've already started posting some positions. So although we are non-renewing 20 probationary staff, some will come back, and we will hire some new teachers as well, as we always do. So you'll be seeing some new teachers on the board agendas as well. Although it is difficult to have to non-renew these teachers, the good news is we don't have to lay off any continuing contract staff, which is a nice thing for us. Anyway, I'd be happy to answer any questions that you have. Otherwise, you have a resolution before you to non-renew these teachers.
Are there any questions? Hearing none, I'll take a motion.
I'll make a motion to approve the resolution relating to the termination and non-renewal of the teaching contracts of probationary teachers.
Second.
I have a motion by Carrero, second by Saucer. Roll call.
Beam?
Yes.
Cordes?
Yes.
Carrero?
Yes.
Saucer?
Yes.
Singwald?
Yes. Motion passes. Thank you.
You.
Our second administrative action is the approval of iPads for grades K through 12, and Ms. Jane Huska.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, school board members, Superintendent Haugen, members of the community. We've had a long conversation around our iPads in our district, and as you were talking, we back there were trying to scramble with the great technology that we have, because not only do you put devices in the hands of the student, you put devices in the hands of the staff. And so I know I'm one of those odd people, and I don't have an iPad, but I truly love my little Surface, and it has brought me wonders. So, but what we've been able to do within the last few minutes as you guys are having conversations were that we were able to find that over the last 3 years, we have reduced our paper costs roughly by 32% for the last 3 years, which totals about $166,000. As it relates to textbooks, back in 10-11, we had a budget for textbooks and curriculum of roughly $350,000. As I was working on the budget for this year, we're looking at $140,000. And we've done that for the last couple of years. It was roughly $150,000, maybe $140,000. So we've been able to greatly reduce the cost that we've had to spend for textbooks. What was the other one? There was one other thing.
It was paper, curriculum, and then we were asking, were you able to figure out what the iPads, if you were to remove
them? Oh, thank you. Yeah, so we took a quick look. We had a spreadsheet that we were just able to manipulate. It's close because also in those numbers will be some professional development and some licensing type things. But if we eliminated iPads in K through 2, it was roughly about $135,000. From taking from that $961,000, that's the one we are looking at. So that would have been the iPad Air 2s and the Mini 2s. If we just simply wipe out the K2, it's roughly about $135,000 per year. So what the administration would like to bring forward and what we would like to propose is that we, as a board, if you would please approve having iPad Air 2s in 3 through 12, iPad 2s for K through 2. And I wasn't able to bring the details of the lease because we, instead of having them run through the gamut of writing three different leases, we would like to get your approval first, and then I will bring back the specific document for the lease.
Madam Chair. So just to clarify what we're at being asked to approve tonight is mm-hmm. which version of these lease options, mm-hmm. and then the next step will be for you to bring back the details of how that lease works, and then we will have an opportunity to approve that again.
Correct.
Well, have the option of approving.
Correct. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Yep, and just one point of clarification, it would be a 4-3 lease. So we would get the lease for 4 years, but we would sell the devices after 3.
Any other questions?
Madam Chair, I would like to recommend a modified or an amended resolution. I appreciate that this would be a step back if we were to reduce the ratio of iPads, and that this would be very difficult for us, but our district is facing a very difficult financial situation, and we're asking a lot of the taxpayers, potentially, if we were to pass all the levies that we would like that are on our wish list. And so I think that we have to take the opportunities to scale back where we can without totally stepping on our strategic plan and trying to stay with it as much as we can, but yet scale back. And I think that, we talked about, I think you had mentioned before, that people were thinking about this in terms of other things that were going to be cut. And if we don't pass a lease, everything's going to be on the table. Everything that everyone is passionate about is going to be on the table. And granted, that's in the general fund and this is the operating fund, but this is still coming out of the same pocket from the taxpayer, either way that we look at this. So I would like to propose an amended resolution to read that we would do a 4-2 lease for the iPad Air 2 for grades 3 through 12 and the iPad Mini for Mini 2 for grades K through 2 in a ratio of 1-4.
I have a motion for an amended resolution. Do I have a second?
Madam Chair, I'd like to make a comment on that as well. This is where my struggle is as well as financially. in talking to the public, and we're making difficult cuts out there, and this was one of the topics that was brought up significantly at the roundtables. I would second that. You know, it's a tough decision to make. It's not an easy decision.
I'm just going to, you can make your comments, but just for clarification purposes, when we do Robert's Rules, make your amendment, make a second, and then we can open it back up for discussion. Just so that you, I mean, we don't do this very often, so I'll take your second. And then with that, I'll open it back up to discussion. So.
No, again, I just struggle with it. It's a tough decision to make, but I think we got to be financially responsible to the taxpayers. And that's one thing that we heard them say out there. And it's a tough decision. I think it's a burden on all of us that we have to make.
Any other comments?
Madam Chair. Yep. First of all, I understand this was developed on the floor. Excuse me. But I would have appreciated a heads up that this was going to be a proposal coming from a board member tonight to have the thought to consider it, knowing what the recommendation from the district was going to be. And second of all, when we look at the data that was given us, all the research data, it would be taking a step back. And to see how amazing these iPads have been tools to customize education, listen to the comments that were presented tonight, I just can't in my right mind go backwards. It's important to differentiate and to have teachers that can have every student is different, and every level of every subject area that those students work at is different. And to be able to reach those kids at their level is crucial, and it would make it even more difficult. And when we know the financial constraints that we are at right now, and we already know that a couple weeks ago we voted to increase class size at these grade levels, this would continue to do a disservice to our students and our residents in our district. And I would advocate that we do not support this amendment. Amendment.
Remember.
Well, I appreciate the concern. I think it's a concern we all share about the taxpayers. I think we also need to keep in mind the needs of the students. And I think moving forward with this amendment would be detrimental for our students in the long run.
Any other questions that come up before a vote? Jay?
Well, Madam Chair, just so we have a kind of a full picture of this, just want everyone to know that, you know, in an action like this, we would save dollars from facilities dollars, but this would come at, I don't know what the cost, a pretty large cost to the general fund, because we would have to run then a completely analog system, go back to paper and go back to textbooks and do things pretty full. I don't really know what the cost would be, but there would be a cost to the general fund by changing this. So I just want you to know that there would be both. And I don't know that the amount would be fully the amount that we saved, but there would be some cost to the general fund.
And thank you. Just one other thing to note. So the difference of the programs that you guys are looking at is roughly, I'm just going to round, is $100,000. And when you put that over our whole tax capacity of our district, I don't have the numbers in my head, but it's going to be like a couple bucks per household. So when you think about that, when you're considering this proposal, that if I spent an extra $2 per month, is it really worth having every kid have a one-to-one device within their hands? And for me, I would. And I would guess that most of the other people would agree to that as well.
Madam Chair. May I add one more thing?
Sure.
Just looking at the numbers that Jane gave us with the how much was saved. I did a quick math between the paper reduction and the curriculum textbook reductions. So within the time since we've went one-to-one, we've saved $376,000 approximately by reducing paper and textbooks. Now, this is just I went and took that, divided it by 13 for each grade level, multiplied it by 3 just to get an idea of those K1 and 2. That still is $86,769 and some spare change. And granted, that's probably not the most accurate representation of if it actually filtered down to those three levels, but in theory, that could be the amount of money we'd have to go by going back to have a newspaper, different curriculum options, as well as we have teachers that have taken 3 years to have professional training on these devices. We become a leader in the state, country, and in the world coming to our district to see how we're doing. And I honestly think we might lose some of that amazing staff because they have the training and tools that another district that might have that one-to-one ratio, that they might end up going elsewhere. And I don't want to see that either.
Madam Chair, just to piggyback on those comments, those were also going from zero iPads to one-to-one iPads and those numbers. And we're not getting rid of iPads. We're reducing the ratio of iPads. So they're still available for use. It will take more coordination. But, you know, and as far as the impact to the district, I mean, as far as not the district, but to the taxpayers, it is just a few dollars per household. But we have roofs to repair and parking lots and things like that as well coming into this fund that we've put off and we don't have the money to do. And if we don't pass a levy, every dollar is going to be extremely important. Mm-hmm. And we haven't passed that levy yet. You know, maybe this is a different conversation if we have passed a levy and we have a different pot of money. We haven't passed it, and we have things that have to be done to our buildings. So that's what I'm trying to consider in this. I totally appreciate all the things that the teachers are doing, the customized education, and how this will be a step back and will require a lot more coordination for the teachers. But I think from a taxpayer standpoint, we need to look. You know, we keep saying, oh, we have to do this, we have to do this, it's in the strategic plan, we have to do this, but at some point, we need to start to scale back.
Does anybody have anything new? I'm sure that we, yeah. I know we're very passionate, but unless somebody has something new, I'd like to move on to the vote.
Madam Chair, just briefly, in terms of the survey data that we had, the teachers capitalizes on how difficult it would be to change the racial proportion. They talked about the frequency that they're using in the classroom, as well as just the simple things about saving content and having that curriculum, the tool available. And I just wanted to highlight that piece. Thank you.
I have a motion and a second. Roll call.
Yes.
Bordes? No.
Guerrero?
Yes.
Sasser?
No.
Sigma?
No. Motion fails. With a fail, we'll go back to the original resolution. And if I can have a motion for the original resolution.
I'll make a motion to direct administration to prepare a lease agreement for iPad Mini 2s for grades K through 2 and iPad Air 2s for grades 3 through 12.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second, but I think you read it differently than written. Maybe not. Because you said Air 2 is not Mini. Okay, no. I apologize. You read it backwards.
Sorry. Yeah, I just flip-flopped them.
Got
sorry.
It. Thank you.
So we have a resolution as printed.
Thank you.
For clarification.
You read
as the administration recommendation. Any other discussion? Otherwise, roll call.
No.
Bordes?
Yes.
Guerrero?
No.
Sasser?
Yes.
Sigmund?
Yes. Motion passes. We're on to our final administrative action, approval of the temporary access road and lease agreement. And again, Ms. Jane Huska.
Thank you. Thank you again for having me. As we get the 195th Street project up and running, there have been some conversations about what to do with the fill. Dakota County, Mathewitz Construction, and Donley Farms got together, and Donley Farms would like to have as much fill as they can from the project. So the majority of the fill will be coming from the ponding basin next to Meadowview, along with the Middle Creek re-meandering that runs along Meadowview as well. So the service road that Mathewitz would like to build on our property will originally come right off of 195th on the west side of the creek. And as you see, as you move south, it jumps over to the east side of the creek, because that's where they have to do the re-meandering and get their equipment in there to dig out the dirt. And it will stay on the east side of the creek as they move south. And you can see the road here, it does cross the creek twice, and I did have conversations with the Dakota County engineer and say, does that really necessary? Seems like a little overkill, and they're like, they describe it as it's the best possible option for them, as where they need to have the equipment and how to dig the fill out for the remeandering of the creek. The other thing that we had concerns about here is along that service road or thereabouts to the north a little bit, there is a tree line that has some wildlife in there, some eagles and whatnot, and so we did express concerns about maintaining that and not disturbing them. Both Dakota County, Mathewitz, they all agreed that they are going to stay as far away as possible from the eagles or any other wildlife that may be in there. As we move a little bit south, there is this site shows you exactly where they're going to be dropping the fill. It shows you the silt fence and the mulch berm that they will be putting in to ensure that they disturb the least amount of land as possible. When the project is over, they will take the service road out and they will put it back to the way that it was before they had to dig all the dirt out. So what I'm asking the board tonight is to approve the temporary land lease and the service road for Mathewitz. Does anyone have any questions?
Does anybody have any questions? Because I actually do. And I'm sorry.
No, it's all right.
That I didn't even think to send it ahead of it because I don't know how convenient it is, but I know kids that ride up and down trying to get to the high school, and that service road comes off. I'm just wondering if there's any opportunity to make that into a permanent trail versus...
Oh, you along the creek, make it a permanent trail, so then it comes out on the service road up to Flagstaff? Because the picture that we have here, we obviously don't want that road to continue because that goes right through the pasture of the Donley Farm. So we would be looking more at this one.
They're not willing to donate just that little swath of... No.
That's our land.
Oh, it is?
Okay. It is. So we'd have to say, don't put your cows back in this area. So, I mean, we can absolutely talk to them more about, instead of the service road flipping to the east side, you know, maybe when they're done, could they just continue that as a path around the pond and connect it to that other dirt service road? We then, as a district, would just have to make sure that, you know, we're not maintaining that. So if kids want to ride their bikes, it's at their own risk.
No, right. Well, and that's, I guess... I would love to see kids not riding their bikes on Flagstaff or the cross-country runners to go onto a trail versus...
Yeah.
Because there isn't much of the shoulder. And I don't know, if they're going to be in there anyway, is there any opportunity for...
I can definitely ask that when the project is done, if they can move the east side to the west and just connect it to the service road. Is that what we're asking for?
Just, I think something off those main busy roads, if there's... Okay. Any additional trail? I mean, if they're going to be in there and have that opportunity, it's just less distance. And that's just my own personal thought.
Madam Chair, I think that's an intriguing idea. My question is how it would impact the creek meandering project?
I don't think it would impact it because it would be something that we'd ask them to do after the project was over. So as you can see on this diagram, the road that's on the east side of the creek and all of the material that would be on that east side, we just ask them to relocate it on the west side. So then it's just a straight shot from 195th down to that. So it's just a big L, or backwards L, back out to 195th. Unfortunately, we don't have land all the way to the high school.
Yeah. So you said this is where that road is our land?
What, the service road?
Is that the road that would be going off to the west, you're saying?
Yes. So that's a service. So there is a chunk, I wish I had a pointer. There is a chunk of land that runs a rectangle right along Flagstaff that belongs to the Christiansen. And that happened when we did a land swap years ago. But then the swath of land from the pond all the way to the service road, and then as we look at this picture where it has the description of the haul route, silt fence, and mulch berm, that is our parcel of land as well.
Any other questions? With that, I'll take a motion.
I'll make a motion to approve the temporary access road and lease agreement between ISD 192 and Mathewitz Construction Company as presented.
Second.
I have a motion by Beam, a second by Cordes. Roll call.
Beam?
Yes.
Cordes?
Yes.
Ferraro?
Yes.
Sasser?
Yes.
Singwald?
Yes. Motion passes. Thank you. We are on to, so we removed the memorial policy for discussion. I believe there was a number of questions that had come up, and so we're looking to have that brought back to the board with some additional information. So that policy discussion was tabled. So we are on to policy action, and we have two policies for final discussion tonight.
Yep. Absolutely. So again, I'm here to present the last reading and discussion about two policies for the board as it relates to establishing a budget and amending a budget. So at this time, do we have any further questions relating to these two policies?
All right. Hearing none, do we have a motion?
I'll make a motion to adopt policy 1013, establishment and adoption of school district budget, and policy 1014, modification of school district budget as presented.
I'll second.
I have a motion by Carrero, second by Beam. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. Since we're heavier to my left, we'll start with board member Beam tonight.
My only comment is that the Minnesota legislature, the House, the Senate, and the governor are still up in arms about what to do about education, and I would still encourage all of our citizens in this district to encourage our legislature and governor to fund education through the basic formula and to only fund preschool if necessary and if it is means tested. It would be my recommendation for making sure that our schools get the funding that we really need to have, so to make our situation not any worse than it is. So,
Madam Chair, thank you. There's a couple things I wanted to mention. I had the opportunity of volunteering at the Meadowview Spring Fling a couple weeks ago, and I made the mistake of saying, I'll do anything you want, and ended up doing the spin art for a couple of hours, which was a great workout, and it was great to see all the frameable art pieces that the students produced. But I have to admit, if I were to rethink it another time, I might use another method to stop the spinner other than my finger. But it was a great time, as well as I want to thank Member Cordes for inviting me to join him on his boardwalks he had recently. I was able to stop by Bachman Middle School, and I want to thank the teachers for the time spent observing their classroom as well as discussing things that they are working on. And lastly, but not least, I want to congratulate the staff and crew and students that were involved in the Miracle Worker play that was held this last weekend. The quality of the acting was incredible, and we are very lucky that we have such talented students and staff and crew to be able to help work on these projects. And I want to encourage everyone that the last few plays that I've been to from our district have been incredible, and if you have a time to drop by, please do, because they're well worth your time to see.
I would just like to thank Dan Miller for his tour at Bachman, Chris Busman for his tour at Dodge, Lisa Edwards for her tour at Meadowview Elementary School, and Bree Buck in lieu of Dr. Geist for the tour at North Trail. I got to see lots of innovative programming in action during these visits, and it was a great way to spend a couple of days not being at work. And I also wanted to plug the Farmington Area Education Foundation's first annual Blue Jean Ball, which will be Saturday, May 16th from 6 to 11 p.m. at the Dakota County Fairgrounds. Dinner provided by the Long Branch, live band by local band Shirts and Skins. Some of your favorite school board members will be in attendance, as well as city council members. And I would encourage anyone in attendance at the meeting tonight, including staff and administration and city council members, to purchase their tickets, or anyone watching at home to contact me. And one final thing, there will be an auction item that might include a tour of historic downtown Farmington and dinner with Jake Cordes. Yeah, so I'm
date?
A date, if you will. So I expect that to be going for high dollar amount.
Treating to dinner? Or?
I will be treating.
Okay.
Downtown farm. I mean, we're not going to like Manny's or anything, but downtown Farmington.
Farming steakhouse.
The steakhouse.
Thank you, Reverend Mercuro.
I just want to say thank you to the administration and teachers for presenting tonight. I know we have some tough decisions out there to make moving forward. And again, your input is very important. I wish we'd get some more people in attendance or send us some comments over email or pick the phone up and call us. But we appreciate all the comments you've been sending in. So thank you.
I wanted to just do a little self-reflection tonight. So bear with me. I've been on the board for 7.5 years. My youngest was in kindergarten when I first started, and it has really hit me. Our student board members contacted us. They couldn't make it tonight, but both with two seniors, and I have a senior in my house, it's a little surreal this year because I feel like I've seen this district kind of full spectrum, and as we approach this spring, it's really exciting to see spring sports come into play. I know the buildings are busy with their MCAs. The juniors are taking their ACTs as an entire class tomorrow. So, I mean, we've gone through these motions many, many times as spring comes, and there's two times a year. Fall's very busy. Spring is very busy. We get ready for graduation, the top 10%, all of those sorts of things. But I just want to say that I have seen some awesome things that have happened in this district, tons of changes. Huge involvement from a number of people from our administration, our community, the people who spend their time in these meetings. And I'm just very grateful for that because I see kind of where my child's going. It's exciting. And I know it's the investment that people have in our community and our kids. And I appreciate it. And I didn't mean to get choked up, but it's neat to see a full K-12 and what comes out of this district. I know we have places to go yet, thank you. But I do appreciate the work in this district that people do from taking care of our buildings and making sure things are functioning to the investment in the students as individuals. So. And I'll cry at graduation, but I won't say anymore.
If you cry at graduation, I'm going to cry at graduation.
Good start.
But with that, I'll take a motion.
Make a motion to adjourn our meeting at 8:10.
Second.
Motion by Saucer, second by Cordes. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Meeting's adjourned.